So chapter 14, semiconductor devices and digital circuits. Electronic devices, a device whose action is based on controlled flow of electrons, is called an electronic device. So these devices are of two types. First is vacuum tubes. They require vacuum diodes. Vacuum diodes are like two electrodes, cathode and anode. And there is vacuum in between cathode and anode. Electrons flow from cathode to anode. And then there is solid state electronic device. So semiconductors are generally solid state electronic devices. So the devices like PN junctions, transistors, and integrated circuits, they are all solid state electronic devices. The question is, why do we need semiconductors? So the reason is, the semiconductors, they offer possibility of controlling number and direction of flow of charge carriers. So when we use semiconductors, we can control number of electrons and also direction of flow of these electrons. Then semiconductors are compact devices. They consume low power. They don't have any vacuum tube, so they are not that much bulky. Their heating effect is low and they are quite durable. Now classification of solids. Based on their electrical properties, that is their resistivity and conductivity, we can classify solids as metals, semiconductors and insulators. So metals are those whose conductivity is maximum and their resistivity is like minimum. For example, for metals, the resistivity is 10 to the power minus 2 to 10 to the power minus 8 ohm meter, and conductivity is reciprocal of resistivity. It is 10 to the power 2 to 10 to the power 8 siemen per meter. For semiconductors, the resistivity is slightly greater than that of metals. It is like 10 to the power 5 to 10 to the power 0, and their conductivity is lesser. It is 10 to the power minus 5 to 10 to the power 0 siemen per meter. Coming to insulators, their resistivity is very high. It is of the order of 10 to the power 8 and beyond, and their conductivity is minimum. It is 10 to the power minus 8 siemen per meter. So let us see some of the features of semiconductors. Their resistivity is definitely higher than that of metals and is less than that of insulators. The temperature coefficient of resistivity is negative in case of semiconductor. It is very high. So on increasing temperature, the resistivity will decrease, whereas the case is reverse in case of metals. In case of metals, if we increase temperature, the resistivity increases. Further, the density of charge carriers is quite low as compared to metals in semiconductors. Now, how do these semiconductors are found in nature? So they may be found in elemental form or as compounds. In elemental form, they are silicon and germanium. As compound, they could be compounds of cadmium sulfide or gallium arsenic, etc. Now let us discuss classification of semiconductors. We can classify semiconductors based on the source and the nature of the charge carrier. They are divided into types, intrinsic or extrinsic. Intrinsic semiconductors are those which are pure lattices. Their impurity is like 1 in 10 to the power 10 parts. That's almost negligible. At 0 Kelvin, they are essentially insulators. It is because they have no free charge carriers. At room temperature, however, due to slight thermal excitation of the valence bond electrons, they create equal number of holes and electrons. Now these holes and electrons, they start to conduct. What are holes? That we'll discuss a little later. Coming to extrinsic semiconductors, these are those semiconductors which are doped ones. So when pure semiconductors are mixed with impurity atoms like pentavalent atom or trivalent atom, then we get extrinsic semiconductor. This is done deliberately so as to improve the density of charge carriers and therefore to increase the conductivity of the material. So extrinsic semiconductors, there are two types, N-type and P-type. We get N-type extrinsic semiconductor when we dope a pure semiconductor, that is intrinsic semiconductor, with pentavalent impurity. Pentavalent impurity are atoms of 15th group. And we get P-type semiconductors when we add trivalent impurity to intrinsic semiconductors. Coming to valence bond model for intrinsic semiconductors. So let us see the pure semiconductor silicon. What happens when it is at low temperature? Let us look at its structure. So this silicon atom, let us consider this one, it has got 4 electrons in its valence shell. Now these 4 electrons are bonded to their neighboring 4 silicon atoms with their valence electrons, so as to complete their octet and to gain stability. Now this structure makes this SI atom, silicon atom, to form tetrahedral bonding with 4 neighboring atoms, and therefore this structure is like diamond. It looks like diamond, and that's why it is called a diamond like structure. So let us look at intrinsic semiconductor at high temperature. When temperature is high, then the electrons are some of the electrons in valence band, they get thermally excited and they leave their place, this covalent bond gets broken and they leave their place and they may move to say conduction band. Now the neighboring electron from the neighboring covalent bond may try to break because of the higher temperature and try to fulfill this vacant place, and therefore creating a hole here. And likewise it will happen, the neighboring electron will move to this place, hole will come to this place, and hole will keep on moving. So it's like the movement of electrons and movement of hole, they occur simultaneously. So at high temperature, equal number of electrons and holes are formed. So now how many holes or electrons are formed? So electrons, number of electrons is given by C e to the power minus Eg, this is energy gap, divided by 2kT. So this is number density of electrons. Okay. So intrinsic charge carriers, which is given by Ni, it is equal to density of free electrons, which is equal to number of holes. So in case of intrinsic semiconductors, we have equal number of electrons and equal number of holes, which are created in pair. Now coming to holes, what is a hole? Hole is essentially a vacancy that is created by absence of electron. Hole is not a particle, but it behaves apparently as a free particle with a positive electronic charge. That is, the charge on hole is plus E. Now, when these electrons move out, they form a current. The motion of electrons forms a current that is called electronic current, and the motion of holes, that forms another current that is called hole current. So total current is sum of electronic current as well as hole current. Now coming to doping, what is doping? Doping is a process of deliberate addition of desirable impurity to a pure semiconductor to increase its conductivity. So to get larger conductivity, to get more conductivity, we add some impurity to the pure semiconductor. That process is called doping. Dopants are those impurity atoms which are added to pure semiconductors. They are of two types. They can be pentavalent dopants or trivalent dopants. Pentavalent dopants are those dopants which have 5 valence electrons in their outermost shell. they belong to 15th group. Example is arsenic, antimony, phosphorus. And the semiconductor that we obtain is called N-type of semiconductor. The other dopant is trivalent dopant. It has got 3 valence electrons in its outermost shell. Example is boron, aluminium and indium. So they belong to 13th group. And the semiconductor that is obtained is called P-type semiconductor, P-type extrinsic semiconductor. Now, how is doping done? Doping can be done in many ways. Like, we can bombard dopant ions on pure semiconductors, or we can add dopants to molten pure semiconductor. The third technique is we can heat the pure semiconductor in an atmosphere of a rich dopant. Now coming to valence band model for extrinsic semiconductors. We have already seen valence band model for intrinsic semiconductor at low temperature and at high temperature. Now we are going to talk about valence band model for extrinsic semiconductor. We have seen there are two types of extrinsic semiconductors, P-type and N-type. When we add pentavalent impurity, we get N-type of semiconductor, extrinsic semiconductor. When we add trivalent atom, then we get P-type of extrinsic semiconductor. So first let us look at N-type of semiconductor. So let us say this is pure semiconductor, silicon, and we have added this impurity of phosphorus. This is pentavalent atom. Now this phosphorus has got 5 valence electrons in its outermost shell, 4 of which combine with 4 neighboring silicon electrons, their valence bond electrons, so as to form covalent bonds. One electron remains unbounded. Now this electron needs a very small amount of energy to get detached from this phosphorus atom and to become free electron. And this much of energy, like 0.01 electron volt, is required for germanium, and 0.05 electron volt is required for silicon. This much of energy is available at room temperature. So at room temperature only, we have lots of free electrons available in conduction band for conduction purpose. Now, since this electron is donated by phosphorus pentavalent atom, this pentavalent atom is called a donor atom. So this dopant is called donor. At room temperature, as I told, there are already many electrons available for conduction. Now what happens when we increase the temperature? When we increase the temperature, then silicon-silicon covalent bonds, they may also get broken, forming equal number of electrons and holes. Overall, since earlier we had some free electrons, now again we have some electrons. So total number of electrons, that is electron density, number of electron density, is much larger compared to number of holes, that is hole density. Therefore, it is called N-type of semiconductor, that is N-type extrinsic semiconductor. So in N-type extrinsic semiconductor, electrons are majority charge carrier and holes are minority charge carriers. We can show the N-type extrinsic semiconductor with positive core, donor atom and the associated free electrons. So this is the core of donor atom. Because it has lost one electron, so it becomes positive, and the electron lost is represented here. Now coming to a P-type extrinsic semiconductor, how it is obtained? A P-type semiconductor is obtained by doping a trivalent atom from 13th group, like boron, aluminium, gallium, to tetravalent silicon or germanium atom. So let us see in this figure. Let aluminium, the trivalent atom is here, it is doped with pure intrinsic semiconductor with silicon atom. Now aluminium has got 3 valence electrons in its outermost shell. So these 3 electrons, they combine with the outermost electrons of neighboring silicon atoms to form 3 covalent bonds. But one of the neighboring silicon atom with one electron cannot form the covalent bond with aluminium because of deficiency of electron here. So this formation of hole. Now this hole is filled with an electron from neighboring Si covalent bond, creating a hole in between Si and Si atom, and this hole is available to move. So there are many holes which are already there available for conduction. Now when temperature is increased, then there are further creation of electron hole pairs because of increased temperature. Overall, number of holes is larger as compared to number of electrons. This is represented here. So number of holes is much larger as compared to number of electrons. Since holes carry positive charge, so positive charge is greater than the negative charge, and therefore it is called p-type semiconductor. Since aluminium atom accepts electron from neighboring silicon covalent bond or from neighboring silicon atom, therefore this aluminium atom is called an acceptor atom. This can be represented here. After accepting an electron, the core of aluminium atom becomes negatively charged with associated hole. So this is how we can represent a p-type semiconductor with a negative acceptor core and associated hole. Now in p-type semiconductor, the majority charge carriers are holes and minority charge carriers are electrons.